keep that up, you know, because we're talking about these emojis, and you see them all the time on your phones, on your devices, and all that kind of stuff. And sometimes you look at these things, I don't know if you're like me, you pull out, you know, the list of emojis that you could possibly pick from, and it seems like it's a growing list all the time, and you're like, which one best describes this situation? And sometimes it can be kind of tricky, can it? Trying to figure out which one, did I mean this? You know, were those tears of laughter or were those tears of crying? I can't remember, you know, which one I'm supposed to use. So I thought we could kind of have a little fun with that today and try to figure out which emojis actually stand for. And here's what we're going to do. I'm going to show an emoji on the screen, and you're going to tell me what you use that particular emoji for. And then we're going to find out from Siri what that actual name is for that emoji, because sometimes they're a little bit different. I don't know if you've noticed that. So we're gonna try this out, see how it works. So let's start with the first one here. What do you guys use that for? Sadness. Okay. Anything else? Just crying? Yeah? Well, let's see how let's see if this will work for us. Loudly crying face. That's what it's actually called. Now, probably you don't actually say loudly crying face when you receive that emoji. You're probably not thinking, oh, loudly crying face. All right, how about this? Let's see about another one. How about this next one here?
Jazz hands.
How many of you go with jazz hands? Jazz, a few of us jazz hands. What else?
Hugs.
What is it?
Happy and excited.
Happy and excited? Okay. Well, let's see what how Siri describes this. Let's see. Click on that text. Uh-oh. Here we go.
Happy face with hugging hands.
Uh-oh. Happy face with hugging hands. That's what that actually is. Thanks, Siri. Appreciate that one. Sometimes our emojis aren't all that appropriate. What's this next one? I think it's, if you ever used this emoji, just be honest in church. Some of you are like, no, never. I've never even seen chocolate pudding before. You know, that's what you're thinking that is, yeah. That's chocolate, yeah, let's see what Siri says it is.
Smiling pile of poo.
And I'm not sure why it says it like that, but.
Smiling pile of poo.
So, just saying, thank you for that, Siri, appreciate it. Let's try this next one. Oh, dog dirt, yeah, that's also dog dirt. Okay, how about this one, what's that?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
P-T-L. Your goal is good.
Praise the Lord, what's that?
Field goal is good.
The field goal is good, yeah, good, it's football season.
The Bills are undefeated.
Woo-hoo. All right, let's see what the...
Hands raised in celebration.
Hands raised in celebration. That kind of makes sense. Yeah, hands are, you know, could be arms up in the air, you know, praise hands, jazz hands, hallelujah, or hallelujah, depending on how you say it. All right, how about this next one here? Let's see what we got here. What's this one?
Praying.
Praying, of course, is praying. Yeah, what else? Anybody?
High five.
High fives. Yeah. Oh, a revelation. Oh, high five. I can use that for high five style. Okay. Anything else? This is... Come on, Siri. Tell me what it is.
Hands with medium light skin tone pressed together.
Hands with medium light skin tone pressed together. Very literal, Siri, it can be sometimes. Yeah. It's like, really? Yes. Thanks, Siri, for that. I appreciate that. How about this next one? Laughing around. Hilarious. Okay, yeah.
Face rolling on the floor laughing.
Face on the floor rolling laughing. Okay, make sure you get that in there. Okay, how about this next one? Nerdy. Any other thoughts on that one?
Cross-eyed.
Yeah, that's true.
Nerdy face with thick horn-rimmed glasses and buck teeth.
Don't forget that. I didn't realize that's literally what it's supposed to. Yeah.
You check these out.
I did. I did check these out. Okay. How about this next one?
Money hungry.
What's that?
Won the lottery.
Money hungry? Won the lottery?
Faced with money symbols on the eyes and tongue.
Wow. That really hit me right here. That emoji right there. Okay. How about this one? How about this next one?
I'm an angel.
Innocent. Blessed. What blessed? Let's see.
Smiling face with halo.
Smiling face with halo. Very, very literal. Thanks for that, Siri. Yeah. How about this next one?
Bill.
Yeah, we looked this one up and
Bill Spencer.
Bill's not even here this week. Yeah, Bill Spencer. Way to go, Siri. Very on top of things. Yeah, you know, this is kind of fun. You know, hopefully you guys enjoyed this. Yeah, I mean, we've been having some fun with some emojis, and hopefully it's been helpful for you. You know, and certainly now, as a result of today, you know what those emojis actually stand for. And so we're going to talk a little bit more about this today. In fact, what we're going to talk about today is, I believe, one of the most prevalent issues in our culture today. It's something that is like kind of running rampant, and it's an issue that seems to only get worse over time. And here's something else about this issue, is it's both outside the church as well as inside the church. It's kind of something that we all struggle with, and while it's not exactly an emotion per se, it certainly is a thought process that tends to control our minds, it controls our behavior, and it controls various different aspects of our life. So this issue that we're going to talk about today is greed. Greed. It's something that we see all the time, and if you're like many of us, you know, there's a feeling like we can never have enough. How many of you've ever just wanted something so badly and you just kind of thought about it and you researched it and I'm going to find the best one of these and I'm just looking forward to getting this thing? Anybody? It's kind of like occupied a lot of your time. If we could only get this one thing, you know, my wildest dreams will come true and then I'll be happy and then I'll never need another thing after this one thing. And then you get it and you're like, well, that was kind of neat. What else do I need now? Okay, now I've got that thing on my wish list. What else is on my wish list? Here's the thing about our wish list, is there's always stuff on there. Right? Anybody have a wish list like on Amazon or something like that? And there's still stuff on there? Yeah. I mean, that's just kind of the way it is with us. You know, once we get that one thing, we cross it off, but then there's still another thing, or another two things, or another five things, or another 500 things I wish I could have. You know? Whether it's a new car or some kind of a toy or a new tool or a house or a gadget, and you get that gadget and you know, you get the new iPhone and then like weeks later the next one comes on and you're like, man, mine's kind of terrible. You know, I need the newest, I need the latest, I need the greatest, I need the fastest, I need more and more and more and more. Isn't that something that we see in our culture all the time? And let's be honest, isn't that something that you struggle with? Or am I the only one that struggles with this? You know, we kind of struggle with this. We need more. We want more. Then, just when you think you've got enough and you're happy and you're content, and then you see something that you can't live without. You know, whether it's through a commercial or maybe you look on Facebook and you see what somebody else has, you're like, oh, theirs is nicer. They have more of it. If I only had that one thing, then I'd be happy. I'm just trying to keep up with the Joneses over there. Thanks, Julie. We're trying to keep up with Julie. And, you know, we've got all of the stuff, but it's never quite enough. We'll go ahead and turn to Colossians chapter 3. That's page 955 if you're using one of our Bibles, 955. If you don't have a Bible, feel free to take that one home with you. We've got lots, and we want to give you something. So page 955, Colossians chapter 3. Now, greed is one of these frequently used emojis that we need to replace somehow. And the beauty about Scripture, or one of the things I find beautiful about Scripture, is it not only addresses problems with the human heart and the human condition, but it also gives us solutions as to how do we overcome these things that kind of plague us. So we're going to read Colossians 3, verses 1 through 17, as we have been throughout the series. And then we're going to pick out a few things for us to work on. Colossians 3, beginning of verse 1, says this: since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your heart on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. And set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life that you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge of the image of its creator. Here, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So today we're not going to focus on this whole text, but we are going to focus on a few verses. We're going to focus on the end of verse 5 and then also some stuff from verses 15 through 17. Verse 5 tells us this: to put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust. Those are the ones that we talked about last week, right? Sexual immorality, impurity, and lust, and also evil desires and greed, which is idolatry. So we're going to kind of focus in on this last part of this text, and we're going to look at it. There's a lot for us to cover. I hope you can fasten your seatbelts. Can you just get the seatbelts out? Go ahead and click it. Ready? Click it or tick it. Come on. Let's do it. Click. I want you to do it. Come on. Come on. Ready? Click. Here's the reason why we got to click it, because I've got 21 points. That's an awful lot. And so we've got a lot to cover. 21 points, which is enough points for the rest of the year, really. I did the math the other day, so the rest of the year the sermons are all going to be pointless, because we're using them all today. So here you go. So 21 points, here we go. We're not going to obviously spend a whole lot of time on each of these. These are kind of going to be some general lists, and if you have notes, that'll be helpful because they're already written down for you. So no cheating, though. You can't play ahead. All right, but I want to start out by clarifying a few terms, okay? It kind of helps us to understand this. The first phrase is evil desires. It talks about evil desires that we need to put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Evil desires is one of those things. Evil desires, I'm calling it just ungodly pursuits. These ungodly pursuits, evil desires and greed, let's face it, those are kind of our default settings, right? That's kind of where we tend to gravitate towards. Evil desires and greed. And some of you are thinking, no, evil desires, that doesn't really describe me. I'm a really good person. Well, listen to Genesis chapter 6. And this is just before God floods the earth. Okay, now Genesis is towards the beginning, right? It's right towards the beginning. So not a whole lot of time has elapsed between creation, the fall of man, the first murder, and now God is like, I'm going to wipe them all out. I'm taking them all out. All right? Evil desires. Read this in Genesis 6, 5. It says this: the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the heart, or every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart, was only evil all the time. Sin just kind of took root, and all of a sudden this sin nature kind of kind of just grabbed a hold of us and it twisted us from the inside out. Of course, that doesn't sound good. You know, these evil desires. Jeremiah 17:9 says this, that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? And once again, I know it kind of sounds depressing, and if you're honest, you're probably thinking, well, that just seems like a generalization. That just seems like an overstatement. That doesn't describe me. That doesn't describe the people in this room or my friends. That's like everybody else, right? How are our hearts really? I think we have some struggles, don't we? We have some struggles, and I think the problem that we face is we don't seem too bad. We seem like we're pretty good. And the reason why we feel that way is because we continually compare ourselves to other sinful, fallen human beings. And because we compare ourselves to other people, we feel pretty good. Isn't that true? Like, well, you know, I'm not perfect, but I'm better than that guy. You know, I'm not perfect, but, you know, I mean, it could be worse. And I think that's a big part of the problem is that we compare ourselves to other fallen human beings. But listen, when we compare ourselves to Jesus, the sinless Son of God, there is no comparison. Even on our best day, we don't measure up. And sometimes we need to keep that mindset, not so that we can do some self-loathing, but so that we can do some self-evaluating. In fact, listen to what Isaiah 64:6 says this. It says, all of us have become like one who is unclean. All of us. And our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Let's talk about our righteous acts. Let's talk about on our best day, we still don't measure up to God's perfect holy standard. And for the next couple of minutes, I just want to share some of those evil desires, some of those ungodly pursuits. And so when I mention these things, you may be tempted to think, well, are these things all wrong? And the answer is no, not necessarily. These things aren't all wrong, but if they go left unchecked, they can become evil desires. So before we go into this list, there's another word in Colossians 3:5 that I think we need to look at. It's the word idolatry. Idolatry. Remember, Colossians 3:5 says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, and then it lists several things, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Now, this is the word of God saying this. This isn't like my opinion on it. This is the text is telling us that this is idolatry. So what's idolatry? I think a pretty simple definition for idolatry is this. It's misdirected worship. It's misdirected worship when we're supposed to be worshiping the one true God, but we worship something else in its place. We worship any number of things. That is idolatry. And I wanted to mention that first as we go into this list, because some of the things on the list aren't bad. However, if we pursue them instead of or to a higher degree than we're pursuing God, then it's a problem. It's idolatry, and God hates idolatry. Did you know that? He hates idolatry. The first commandment of the Ten Commandments in Exodus 23, says, 20 verse 3 says this, you shall have no other gods before me. That's how he starts the list out. And so, what are some of these evil desires, these ungodly pursuits? Well, it just so happens I came up with a list, and they all start with the letter P, because everybody loves it when I alliterate. Not really. But as I was kind of come up with this list, man, it just kind of seemed to make sense. So just stay away from P words and you'll be fine. Right? That's the moral of the story. The first one is power. Power. You know, this can be an ungodly pursuit. It can be an evil desire if you're on this quest for power, especially if you abuse that power or if you trample over others to gain that power or to keep that power. Certainly, if your quest for power plays a higher priority than actually submitting to Jesus, it's an idol, it's an evil desire. So what happens when we pursue power is we tend to put ourselves at the top, and it's the complete opposite of what Jesus tells us that we should be like. We should be servants, right? The second one is popularity. You know, some people will do just about anything to gain popularity. In fact, sometimes just trying to gain people's acceptance can be an evil desire in itself. Sometimes when we're trying to gain popularity, let's face it, we we kind of compromise some things. We compromise our faith, and we can compromise our biblical convictions just because we want people to like us. And so, I don't want to be perceived as somebody that really, is one of those Jesus people, so we just kind of compromise some things in pursuit of popularity. On a related topic of popularity, just the idea of relationships and people and valuing people above God. Listen, this isn't popular, but listen, if we value our families and our spouses and our kids or any other relationship more than we value our relationship with Jesus, that thing, that person has become an idol. And I know that sounds kind of counterintuitive because, aren't we supposed to love those people close to us? Yes, absolutely. In fact, Jesus said we're supposed to love our neighbors as ourselves, so we're supposed to love people. But first and foremost, we need to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then love our neighbors as ourselves. If we get things in the backwards order, we have a problem. It's become idolatry. It's not fun, but it's the truth. Because remember, idolatry is misdirected worship. And sometimes we can worship even our own families more than we worship God. And that's an issue. Number three is possessions. Possessions. Now, this is kind of both an obvious thing that people chase after, and yet it's also subtle. It's obvious when other people are chasing after possessions, but it's more subtle when it's us. Because we can justify it when it's ourselves, but other people, man, they've got a problem, right? So our possessions, if it's something that we chase after, and let's face it, this is another easy one to kind of get caught up in as we chase after one thing, after another, after another, after another. If I can only have this next thing, the bigger, the better, the faster, the whatever, it becomes a problem. Number four is promotion. This is kind of similar to chasing after power. Promotion, when promotion becomes our biggest pursuit in life, then work becomes such a high priority that everything else tends to suffer, including our families, in our church, and the other people that are close to us. And sometimes, let's face it, when it comes to promotion, sometimes there's a temptation to even sacrifice our own integrity as we compromise things for the sake of promotion. So it can become an evil desire, an ungodly pursuit, something that somebody chases after, other than God. Verse 5. Number 5 is this, is pleasure. Pleasure. And this could be any number of pursuits. It could be food, it could be sex, it could be entertainment, it could be hobbies. Anything that just kind of takes you away from God and pursuing Him. If it becomes a higher priority than our relationship with Jesus, it's a problem. Number 6, physique. Physique. I know it begins with P, isn't that awesome? I want to say physique because all the other... but physique. By the way, I was on the treadmill when I was typing this one up. I'm like, okay. Oh, I'm like, oh, here's one. Yeah, But think about it. How many times do we make our appearance or our body shape or our looks the biggest priority in our lives? You know people like this, right? And sometimes we are that person where we prioritize to a greater degree than God. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't be good stewards of what God has entrusted to us, because we should, and we need to do a better job at that, and we need to exercise discipline and self-control. Those are all true, but if it becomes a higher priority than God, then it's a problem. Number 7 is prosperity. Prosperity. Chasing after money and wealth is clearly in conflict with what the scriptures teach. That's why Jesus says this in Matthew 6:24. Jesus says, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Now, I think you could probably substitute money in there for a lot of different things. You cannot serve God and this. You cannot serve God and your own power. You cannot serve God and your own possessions. You cannot serve God and go after your own popularity at the same time. You're going to love one, or you're going to hate the other. It just seems that money is an easy target because it's something that many of us kind of chase after. And it becomes an idol in our hearts. All of these things can become evil desires that if they get in the way of our relationship with God, and if they compete with our allegiance to God, and His will for our lives. Are these things all bad? No. But they can take us down the wrong path if we pursue them in an ungodly way. Does that make sense? I'm not down on all of these things. I don't think Scripture is down on all these things. But if they become a higher priority than God, it has become an idol in our lives, an evil desire. So how do we overcome these evil desires? What do we do about it? Is there some kind of an antidote? Not really, so we should probably just go home. I'm just kidding. You know, we overcome these desires by desiring something else, right? We have to replace that desire. So in your notes, you've got this, that we can overcome evil desires with godly desires. Now, we're not going to spend a ton of time on each of these things, but here's seven godly desires that we should each be pursuing if we call ourselves a follower of Jesus. If we call ourselves a follower of Jesus, we should be following Jesus, right? So this isn't an exhaustive list, but it's just one I came up with, so feel free to add to the list. Here's seven godly desires. Number one is God's kingdom. God's kingdom, Matthew 6:9 says this. This then is how you should how you should pray. Jesus is talking about prayer. He says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." By the way, what happens when we desire God's kingdom? I think we stop building our own kingdom. God's kingdom becomes a higher priority than building our own kingdom. You see how that kind of is kind of a way to kind of defeat these evil desires? There's, in fact, a second godly desire in Matthew 6:10. He says, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So another desire, we should desire God's will. How many of you would like to desire your own will sometimes? This should be every hand, by the way. This isn't a trick question. Yeah, we all have a plan. We all have some things that we think would make our lives better. There's nothing wrong with that. However, when we desire our will in place of or above and beyond God's will, now we have a problem. So God's will. Again, when we desire more of God's will to be done, we automatically desire less of our own will. So we need to place it in a higher priority. Number three is God's word. God's word. The truth is we should have a burning desire for God's word. And if we don't, you know, we're not really as committed to following Christ as we'd like to believe. If there's no desire to really be in God's word, then there really isn't that great of a desire to know God. So we've got to work on this. Let's face it, you can't really follow Christ unless you're saturated by His words. So there should be a growing desire for God's word. Number four, God's people. God's people, do you love God's people? Do you love His church and what God is up to in the world? If there's no desire to be a part of what God has established and called His bride, then how can we say that we love Christ? How can we say that we love Christ if we don't love His bride? Now, just to be clear, just because you're here today, that doesn't mean that you love God's people in His church. So there's another thing that we need to work on. Number five is this, God's glory. We should be pursuing God's glory. Well, what does that mean? How do we do that? Well, I think here's a good way to look at this. I think a good way to see if this is really a true pursuit of yourself is to ask yourself a couple of questions. You can add to the list, but here's a couple of questions I came up with. If I want to know, am I really pursuing God's glory? If you want to know that, here's a question you could ask yourself. What have I done in the last 30 days that pointed people directly to God? Am I really interested in giving God glory, in pointing people to God for His name, for His fame, for His glory? What have I done intentionally to point people and to direct people to God? A related question is this. What areas of my life am I pointing people to me and to my own glory rather than to Jesus? So if there's areas in our lives where we're pointing to ourselves and look at me and look at my accomplishments and look at all of the stuff that I have, then we're not really pointing glory to God. We're pointing to our own glory. It's kind of convicting. Number six is this, God's blessing. We should desire God's blessing. You know, there's nothing wrong with desiring God's blessing. But at the same time, we need to make sure that we're blessable. You know, we need to be people that are choosing to do things that please God. See, if we're not trying to please God, we shouldn't expect God to please us with his blessing. Does that make sense? And last but not least, the seventh godly desire is God. This is where it should all start. We should have a desire for God, to pursue God. Above everything else, we should desire God. For example, if we desire God's blessing more than we desire God, that's a problem. So our desire for God and our love for God needs to be first and foremost our highest priority. Psalm 42:1 says this, as the deer pants. By the way, when I was writing this down, you know, I was just kind of writing stuff, you know, before I actually found all the scriptures. I'm like, oh, we could use this verse. And I just wrote, as the deer pants. And I was thinking, deer don't have pants. And I kind of had a little chuckle. I think there's an emoji for that when I was rolling on the floor, you know. Anyway, deer do not have pants. But as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. In other words, we ought to have this longing, this thirst to be quenched by God himself and nothing else. Psalm 37:4 says this, take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. To delight in something, it literally means to be fully satisfied in. That we should be fully satisfied in God. And when we're fully satisfied in God, then he gives us the desires of our heart. You know why? Because our desires begin to change. Because all of a sudden we're fully satisfied in him. And when you're fully satisfied in something, you don't go longing and looking for something else. Right? So to delight in the Lord, to be fully satisfied in God, is saying, listen, God, you are my greatest joy, my greatest pleasure. Why in the world would I look for something else? I want to delight in you and have my desires change, to have my heart change. Remember, the heart is the center of our emotions. Matthew 5:6 says this, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. They will be satisfied. So when we feed on righteousness, it keeps all of our other cravings for evil desires at bay. So we need to feed on righteousness rather than feeding those other cravings. So there are seven evil desires and seven godly desires. Let's talk a little bit about greed and how to overcome it. Colossians 3:5 once again says, put to death. That sounds pretty drastic, doesn't it? Put to death. Why can't we just say, you know, put it away for a while? No, this is put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. How many of you think that America has kind of a greed problem? Anybody? It's easy to point at America. America, we have this problem. Yeah, me? Well, you know, maybe a little bit. Yeah, we have a greed problem. You know, it's all about us, and God bless America, and nobody else is kind of our mindset, you know, sometimes. You know, God bless us, look at us, and we're, you know, and God, would you give us more, and even when we have so much in surplus, we want more. We've got a problem. The definition of greed is this, it's a selfish and excessive desire for more of something, such as money, more of something than is needed. So we have needs. Everybody has needs. Every human on planet Earth has needs. But when we desire more and more and more and more, it becomes a problem. It becomes our God. It becomes an idol. And I know this is a real struggle for many of us. And it's easy for us to become discontent with what we have. It's also easy for us to focus on what we don't have rather than on what God has already given us. Greed. So is there a cure? How do we overcome greed? Well, in your notes I wrote this. We can overcome greed with gratitude. We can overcome greed with gratitude. There's an English writer, G.K. Chesterton, that says this. When it comes to life, the critical thing is whether you take things for granted or you take them with gratitude. So are we going to take everything for life for granted? Like, we're entitled to this, and I'm entitled to this, and I'm supposed to have this, and, you know, God's got to bless me because, you know, I'm a good person or whatever. Do we take everything for granted, or do we take it with gratitude? That God has blessed us, and God already has given us so much. And there's a big difference between those things. The Apostle Paul writes this in Colossians 3:15. He says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace." Listen to this. And be what? Thankful. And be thankful. That's such a short word, small thing that, you know, we can kind of quickly gloss over. There's so many other words in here, but what is he saying? He says we need to be thankful. And be thankful. Verse 16, it says, "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly," which is kind of interesting, a little play on words. You know, hey, you want all of this, these other things, you struggle with greed. You know, you already have something that is very rich. You already have something that's very rich. "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly." You want to be greedy for something, be greedy for God. Be greedy for his word. "Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Singing to God," how? "With gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus." How? "Giving thanks to God the Father through him." You see that little theme that's kind of going on there in those last few verses? It says, be thankful, sing to God with gratitude in your hearts, giving thanks to God. How do we overcome our greed? We do it with gratitude. Gratitude, I believe, is the key to overcoming greed. I think each of us can do a bit better job at expressing gratitude. So to complete this trilogy of sevens, here we go. Let's kind of wrap this up. Here's seven habits of highly grateful people. I've got a book that I like called Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. So I'm like, seven habits of highly grateful people. Here they are. Number one is this, that grateful people worship. Grateful people worship. Now remember, our definition of worship that we've been using for years and years and years is this, is that worship is my response to God for who he is and what he does. It's my response to God for who he is and what he does. So grateful people worship. Why? Because when we recognize who God is and what he does, we can't help but be grateful. When we're looking to see the things of God and how God has intervened and how God's provided, it causes us to respond with gratitude. It causes us to respond with worship. Number two is this, that grateful people give generously. They give generously. Now, if you want to deal with greed head on, here's a great way to do it. If you want to deal with greed head on, give stuff away. Give stuff away, including but not limited to money. Listen, grateful people, they recognize that everything that they have has come from God. And that they've only been entrusted with it. And that we're to be good stewards of what God has entrusted to us. So if we have a greed issue, one of the antidotes to that is to give generously. It's to say, listen, these possessions, they don't possess me. They don't. So we want to deal with greed? Give generously. Number three is this, that grateful people serve humbly. Once again, when we recognize how blessed we already are, when we recognize what God has done for us, it puts us in a position or in a posture to serve others and to bless others the way that we have been blessed. That makes sense? You know, when we recognize all that God has done for us, we should be grateful to the point where we serve others and we bless them. Number four, it says that grateful people exude joy. Have you ever met somebody that's joyful all the time? Like, at least it seems that way. They're happy. You just love to be around them. Like, I don't see nobody raise their hand. Two people raise their hand. It's like, because most of the people that we're around are miserable, right? Yeah. Look at your neighbor. No, don't do that. But sometimes you get around some people, they're just happy. They exude joy. And I think a big part of that is because they're filled with gratitude. They're filled with gratitude. They exude joy. They see everything as a gift from God, which kind of leads to this next one. Number five is this, that grateful people value the small things. You want to be more grateful? Look for the small things, not just the big things. But look at the small things. Grateful people, they thank God for what they have rather than complaining about what they don't have. They see everything, the big things, the small things, as a gift from God rather than feeling like they're entitled to God's goodness. We value the small things. You want to be more grateful? Here's another one, number six. Grateful people always display hope. They display hope. People that demonstrate gratitude, they're typically optimistic. Right? Aren't they? They're typically optimistic. When it rains, they're the type of person that is looking for the rainbow in the rainstorm. Obviously, there's a rainbow somewhere. Right? When they're struggling or when they're suffering, they're looking for lessons that God may be teaching them in the midst of that. And that kind of leads to the next one. Number seven is this, that grateful people grow during hardship. Grateful people, they rise above their circumstances. They choose gratitude despite their circumstances. These are some incredible habits of gratitude, right? These are some things that we can apply to our lives. You know, when we're facing some things, when we're facing things with mixed emojis, you know, how should I respond to this? You know, my heart's kind of leading me this way. Well, let's not completely trust our hearts, right? Because our hearts are desperately wicked. Who can understand it? You know, we need to have a change of heart. We need to have a new heart. And so, one of the ways we can do that is fill our hearts with gratitude. Your homework is this. As you look through that list, which of these things describe you? You can look at all the lists and like, oh, this one I struggle with, or this one describes me to a T. Identify a couple of those things that you struggle with. And once you've identified that, you've learned something about yourself, and then you have a choice to make. Is that going to be something that defines me? If it's a negative thing, certainly you don't want that to define you. If it's a positive thing, absolutely, pour into that. Listen, we can overcome evil desires with godly desires, and there's plenty of things. There's plenty of evil desires out there that can kind of, we naturally are gravitated towards. Those are the default things that kind of are always appearing on our radar. But desiring God, that must be a conscientious decision. We cannot rely on our default because we naturally desire ourselves. We naturally default to us. We're naturally self-centered. And so if we want to overcome greed and evil desires, then we need to conscientiously and with great intentionality desire God, to pursue Him. You notice in the bottom of your notes, there's a devotional for the week. You can check that out, and we try to have some resources in there for every single week. That's a part of it. That's a step. Certainly, just reading a 10-minute devotional isn't going to change your heart, but it's a start, and it's a step. And secondly, we can also overcome our greed with gratitude. There again, there's some habits there that we can put into place that just help us become more grateful. And if you're anything like me, you've got some work to do. And my goal isn't to somehow make you feel guilty. I hope you don't walk out of here and you're going to get beat up again, you know. I've kind of failed that test. You know, most of those ungodly ones, that was me. And I, you know, that's not my goal. My goal isn't to make you feel guilty. But really, the goal for each of us is to pursue God. And sometimes we need to find out what some of our shortcomings are so that we can make some adjustments. You know, my goal for myself and for you is to crave our God more than we crave our greed. The Apostle Paul had it right when he said this in Colossians 3:5. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Those things that we kind of gravitate towards, we need to put that to death. And then he says in verse 2, in place, we need to set our minds on things above, not on earthly things. And when we focus on the things of this earth, greed tends to set in. Our desires for God to turn to desires for ourselves, and they turn evil. So this week, may we choose to focus more on God than on our greed. And may our greed turn to gratitude. You stand, let me pray with you.